Okay. A follow-up to some of the niggles. I gave the updated maps a test, and apparently it does have 3D turn-by-turn navigation. However, whether it's the position of the phone on my dash or the decreasing number of GPS satellites, thinking the hoo-ha bar about the 2010 predicted GPS system failure, I don't know why it takes several minutes to actually get a GPS fix and flip from the overhead map into the traditional 3D display, which incidentally lacks the speed and other informational notices of other GPS turn-by-turn systems. I mean, what the heck, it's free, so what on earth am I moaning about? But the speed readout was more precise than my analog speedometer, and the advanced turning indicator, with direction of and distance to the next turn, saving me from having to look at the map too much. I mean, let's face it, when I'm driving on country roads, this sat nav turns into a complete gyroscopic mess that can make my head spin. The speed indicators also helped me to be aware of the constantly changing speed limits in the UK's countrywide systems, with pockets of built-up areas, speeds can change from 50 to 30 to 40 to 20 and back to 50 again, with the kind of blistering insanity that only the British seem capable of. The voice is pleasant enough, but it's definitely more robotic than the others, and it's more informationally chatty. And that's neither here nor there, but when my hands-free visor kit is activated, the phone doesn't use it. It doesn't use it to amplify its announcements, which means I can barely hear it over the radio and the engine noise. I guess it just lacks the option to do it, which is definitely a problem with this sat nav. A lack of options. I would recommend, however, that you get something like this. It's a cigarette lighter to USB power converter, and it's useful for older cars like mine that don't have a USB power socket in the dash. Oh, and you're likely to need a slightly longer cable than the standard one that comes with it, in order to be able to charge it while it's in the car cradle. I haven't yet seen anything to suggest that we'll be switching to either the Russian GLONASS or the Chinese CNS for our turn-by-turn direction finding in future. Who knows what's going to happen with the US direction finding system? We just might find ourselves using maps once again. I'm not sure whether the S2 and other devices like it will have the option to switch direction source should the worst happen. Who knows what the hardware inside is capable of? But from what I've read, the S2 antenna is in the base of the unit, which is probably not helping the sat-nav positioning either when it's sat in the dashboard. But that's just a guess. Talking about a lack of options, it's exactly that which is a pain in the neck when it comes to using the S2 as a teleprompt device. The display timeout only has a maximum of 10 minutes, which, while okay in itself, is pushing it when it comes to a reasonably comfortable teleprompt presentation session. It can easily force unplanned and badly positioned breaks in the presentation chat. If it were taken to, say, 20 minutes, or even allow the user to turn off display sleep altogether, then that would be a serious improvement on this function. As you can see here, I've used cling film between the arms to suspend the S2 underneath the mirror. A bit of a dirty trick, but it works. Okay, so how would I conclude the standard package that's come with the S2 from Orange? I actually like it. I like it a lot. I can't compare the S2 with the iPhone because I've never actually had an iPhone. And I've never particularly wanted one for various reasons. And I think from some of the stuff that I've been seeing online and the responses to some of my posts that there's other people out there who have not wanted to go for iPhone for their own personal reasons, and the S2 really is a solid answer to that. My niggles against it's a very large package that's come with the S2, and my niggles against it are, on the whole, relatively small. The big one for me was the open document format issue. I really, with other phones, I found myself close to the end of the year of using them. I've been looking forward to the next phone. Not so this one. I'm in a 2-year contract, and I can really see me using this phone for 3 or 4 years into the future. I'm hoping that the future brings better battery technology for the phone. Not that I'm getting an unreasonable response from it, with calls, a bit of internet work, emails, that sort of thing. I'm getting about a day and a half from it. And that is after a few charging cycles, by the way. And I'm hoping that with the other forward advances in battery technology, that there will be a better battery out for it in the next year or two. We'll see on that. I have been coming back to the Samsung Fold rather tentatively. A fair chunk of my earlier phones were all Samsungs. One of the U range, the D500, the D600, and a few in between. And one of the things that really drove me nuts about Samsung was the grief with their software. And software that came with one phone wouldn't talk with another phone. So in order to transfer contacts, I'd have to be sat at one phone, Bluetoothing one each contact in turn to the next phone. Luckily, I think with the D600, by that point it had become possible to mark all the contacts and send all the contacts via Bluetooth. By that time, I'd had enough of the Samsung phones, but their cameras on those phones were brilliant. Something I'm finding less of a performance from the S2's phone camera, less of a performance from that, and that is starting to knock me a bit. The macro mode I found was in there, but it was under a different, rather than being with the rest of the shooting modes, it was in its own little section with just about a couple of other options. And it's better now that I've got hold of the focusing issue, but it really is a two-handed phone camera, to make the best of it. If you are gripping the phone with one hand, grip it with the other hand, because if you're gripping it with the hand that's on the side of the button, you've got a problem to get your finger far enough under to hit that shutter release. So it's better to hold it from the other side and have your finger going all the way over to the phone. I'm definitely missing the two-stage button depression for the phone. Definitely missing that. But on the whole, my niggles are smaller. There is the opportunity to go forward with this phone. There are updates coming down with the applications. I did try my best to go with Orange because of my experience with O2. Yes, as a friend pointed out, the support for the people on the pay-as-you-go is vastly different to the support on the contract. But my net chat with them was so bad, and it was basically neither service. My net chat with them was so bad that there's no way I touched them. So I really wanted to work with Orange because I do get the feeling that if an update comes down that bricks the phone, I do have the feeling that I would get the support from them. So that pretty much wraps up the standard package that came with the S2 from Orange. I'm impressed. I love the phone. For viewing only did fire a question at me, and an important question is whether I was considering some protective skins or cases for them. Well, when I went for the hip case, for the belt case, I did get one that I'd have to thread the belt through rather than having the clip, because pretty much the most of my crashes and falls have been from the clip coming off whatever trousers I'm wearing. It is going to be a pain for me because a chunk of my trousers do not have belt loops, so I've had to wear the belt separately and just drape a blouse over the top of it so that nobody can see that the belt is actually separate to the trousers. But I think that will guard against most of the knocks. So if I do, I will be looking at the protective cases for one that will protect the phone, but won't stop it from going in that holster, and the holster does feel a little bit on the tight side. We'll see what the future brings on that. I wasn't thinking of a cover for the screen. I did get one which came free with the hip holster, but I found it was more a pain to get on the phone and use than to just leave the phone unprotected from the front. So we'll see what the future holds regarding the skins. But I really do feel that having put the holster, the hip holster, on the belt loop firmly, I feel that's mitigated a lot of potential disasters. Time will tell. I was offered the insurance, but firstly, I am covered to a degree by the house insurance, and with the cost of the insurance, by the time you take it over the 2-year contract, it's better to just put up a standing order into the bank account, and just leave it there accruing some interest. Because the other thing that I've suggested with the laptops and that I try and do is when you buy a laptop, a netbook, anything like that, is to split the cost over about 3 to 4 years and start putting that amount of money each month into an account. So by the time that equipment has come to the end of its life, you've already got the money there to go out and get your next device. That's something that I've tried to do. That's something that I've recommended to people. Some have taken it up, some haven't. It's their own choice. Sometimes you're in a situation like I am now that you haven't got the money to be able to do that, because we are in a pretty dark situation right now. But protective cases and skins, we'll see what happens, because I can't really get a skin that interferes too much with the hip pouch. We'll see what happens. Time will tell. So, the bog standard thing, as it comes with the packages from O2, yeah, I'm happy with it. A lot of other people, sorry, Orange, I'm happy with it. A lot of people have been complaining that there's been an overload of applications. Yeah, there's a few on there. I think I've got 4 pages of applications, the majority of which I'm comfortable with and happy with using. So, yeah, I don't feel that it's been overloaded, because I can always make front screens and put shortcuts to the applications that I want on those front screens. So I don't feel that too much of an overload is being hard done by, actually, to be quite honest. So yeah, I'm happy with the phone. I think I can see me using it beyond the 2 years that I've got the contract for. It's just a great phone, and I'm getting on with it. If a few other things like tweaks to YouTube and other bits and pieces happen, yeah, I'll be great with it. On balance, for what it is, for what it's delivering, gorgeous phone. I'm grateful that I've got it. So, yeah, take care. This sums up the standard package. We'll see what the future brings with other stuff and modifications. For now, bye.